Good evening, everybody. I'm David Hare, and about a few years ago, 2 years ago, I wrote a play about the financial crisis. And, oh, can I ask everybody first, sorry, to turn off their mobile phones before we start. I'm here tonight to interview Paul Mason, who helped us with the play. And my situation with this subject matter is more or less as if I were interviewing Stephen Hawking. I understood it while I was reading it, but I no longer understand a word of it. So I'm hoping that Paul is going to tell us again, make it all clear to me again, because I must admit I've never worked on a subject that I understood so completely while I was writing it and have forgotten everything about so totally since. And also a lot has happened since. And so tonight I'd like to talk both about the roots and about what's happened since. And so I'll talk to Paul, ask him some questions for a while, probably about 45 minutes, and then I'll ask everybody else to ask questions of him. This is, of course, tied to his book, I should explain, Meltdown, The End of the Age of Greed, to which he's added new chapters, and I imagine we'll go on adding chapters as things develop. When I wrote the play 2 years ago, then it was understood that there was a seminal crisis in capitalism. Alan Greenspan of the Federal Reserve said, we have discovered a flaw in the model. And the Chicago economists, who had been in fashion for the previous 20 years, said, back to the drawing board. Now, somehow, in the time since that play was written, a crisis in capitalism has been changed into a crisis in welfarism. And we are somehow presented with a completely different narrative by this government, that the crisis is not a crisis in capitalism, but it's a crisis about what the state can now afford. Obviously, as someone who wrote Stuff Happens and who saw the misappropriation of an attack on the American mainland for a group of unscrupulous people to go off and do what they were planning anyway, and which had nothing to do with 9/11, i.e. attack Iraq, it looks to me as if what we're witnessing is exactly the same thing. The appropriation of a crisis, which was a genuine crisis, for a group of people, and it's significant that we see again Nigel Lawson, Norman Lamont, all these people are back on our television sets as if it were the 1980s. They are appropriating the crisis to do what they wanted, which is to cut back the welfare state. And so, really, Paul, how has this change in narrative been achieved? And do you accept that's the change in the narrative?
I think there's a change in the narrative from the crisis of banking. And thank you, everybody, for coming, by the way. There's a change in the narrative from the crisis in banking to a crisis of the state. So if you look at this from the point of view of Britain, it is exactly as you say, that the problem has become one of welfarism and the size of the state. But if I just step back and try and... I mean, the book does contain two new chapters. One of them's a big critique of political economists who've tried to get their heads around this, and the other one is a sort of periodization of the crisis. And let me just explain how I see it. The first phase, it's like that scene in Alien. They stab the monster. The monster's blood turns out to be acid. It goes through one floor of the spaceship. So they run down and see how many floors it's going to burn through. So on this metaphor, the first thing it does is that the acid hits the banking system. And it, within a week, I was there in September 08 in New York, it burned through Lehman, AIG, the other four investment banks, and then through to the point where the ATMs nearly stopped. By February 2009, it's burned through into output. So output is collapsing. Globalization is retreating, trade is collapsing, and of course the stock market's halved. But that's just phase one. Phase two, the state is the next floor, and the, you know, in the Alien analogy, this is a big thick floor, because the state says, all over the world, we're going to take on stopping this crisis. The question becomes, can the state contain it? Now, in large parts of the world, it did. China. Germany. But what my thesis is that what the acid does here is it burns through the weakest bits of that floor, the euro, the American political bipartisan deal, up in flames, and now British, the social democratic model of the British welfare state. It's kind of hit all of these things, and so if you contextualise the argument between Labour and the Tories, Brown, Osborne, etc., it is that. Now, of course, it's not something you will like. I have to remain kind of objective about it and try and ask why it is and where it's going, and maybe that's something we could discuss.
Yeah.
But it certainly is the case that this crisis has, having floored the banking system, now floors the British state, and phase three, the last floor before we get to outer space, as it were, and you get, you know, all the impacts there, the last defence is relationships between classes and countries. Because what everybody's now trying to do is to offset the cost from one class to another, or from one country to another. And that's, I think, the world that opened up with the collapse of the near collapse of the euro in May.
But why, just explain to me, why is the first thing to be destroyed, namely the banking system, why is that to be saved, but the other things like the welfare state are not to be saved? What's your understanding of why
there is a rational explanation for that, and that is, if you didn't save banking, look, we now know stuff we didn't know when I wrote the first edition of the book. We know that in addition, okay, just off the top of my head, the total value of the British banks was about 43 billion. The stock market value at the on the day, I remember printing them all off and putting them on the desk live in front of me on Newsnight, because I knew they were effectively about to bail them out, to the tune of, one guessed, hundreds of billions. And as indeed that is what they spent on it. So I said, well, look, their combined value is 43 billion. They're going to spend hundreds of billion. You could buy these things several times over. What we didn't know is that they'd already lent them 90 billion in secret. Just as they were saying to John McDonnell, the Labour MP, how dare you call for the nationalisation of these banks? They had nationalised them twice over. So, okay, they had to be saved. This is the point. If you don't save them, you are into the world where, you know, you're into deliverance. You're into the world where the American right lock and load, lock their gates, put the CCTV cameras. Because if the ATMs do stop, remember what the, you know, you remember what the fuel protest was like. We've had these dystopian visions, actually, in the last 10 years. I was in New Orleans during Katrina. I remember what that was like. I'd rather, personally, rather save the banks than for London to go like Katrina.
Yeah, I understand the first round of blackmail, which, as I understand it, is to say that the economy cannot survive without, unless the state intervenes in a socialist way to help the banks, and that's what they did. But the second round of blackmail, which is essentially for the financial community to say, and we must be allowed to continue in exactly the same way that we continued before the crisis, because if we don't, then the vigour of our entrepreneurial genius will be stemmed, and when that happens, you will not be led out of recovery. Mm. So there's a second round of blackmail, yeah, which I don't mind the first round of blackmail, I accept that,
yeah,
but the second round of blackmail is harder to take when, in my inadequate understanding, the people who are blackmailing me are the people who were responsible for the crisis in the first place.
Funnily enough, this is the exact problem that Mervyn King and his lieutenants, above all a guy called Andrew Holden, who's the head of financial stability at the Bank of England, are grappling with. But they grapple with it in a technocratic way rather than an emotional or political way, as we might. And they ask the same question. Is it possible that what has happened is that the banks have, since the 12th century, you know, increasingly demanded a safety net, a bigger and bigger safety net, and the state has extended that safety net, and the net result has been for the banks to take greater risks. And Haldane, in this seminal paper produced last year, it's on their website, says yes, that's what's happened.
Yes.
The banks have, you know, to use the English colloquialism, taken the piss out of the rest of us and the state. Now, what do we do about it is something that Mervyn King is still grappling with. Because if you accept stage one, okay, bail them out, Stage two is bail them out and then pump money into the economy. Okay, if you pump money into the economy through quantitative easing, making it risk-free to be an investor in these markets, what you do, because these contain some of the greatest minds in the world, really and non-ironically, at doing one thing, making a lot of money from low-risk situations, turning low risk into high reward situations. Well, if you give them a risk-free opportunity, they fill their boots. This is what happened in 2009-10. The banks do that. And I think everybody looked at it and said, you could even say that's a temporary impact that you could live with. It's not nice. You could maybe take some more tax off them. Not many people were prepared, not many governments were prepared to take more tax off them. But the ultimate question is the one posed by Mervyn last night, actually, in New York, and by the Haldane paper, is right, what is the new relationship between the banks and the state? And is it capital cushion? Do we force them to hold more money? That doesn't seem to change their behavior. Do we break them up? That's on the agenda. Volcker puts it on the agenda. The $400 million lobbying industry takes it off the agenda in America. It's on the agenda here. We'll see what happens. Mervyn King last night even postulated the idea of banning, effectively, modern banking. So you get the Bank of England governor making a speech saying, well, maybe we should ban the essential relationship. Money creation, banks create money, and then speculation can't be done in the same organisation. So we are by no means at the end of this debate, but it's gone underground. It's not there in the Daily Mail anymore.
Okay, we'll just deal with this parenthetically. This is a parenthetic subject, but obviously the great coup of Gordon Brown's government was meant to be independence for the Bank of England. And yet Mervyn King, who in theory was therefore meant to be, well, sorry, it wasn't Mervyn King at the time, but the bank was meant to become independent.
Yeah.
But in fact, the bank has become deeply political and deeply involved in the political life of the country. In other words, at the time that the Bank of England was clearly disapproving of the Chancellor of the Exchequer's policies, that made life difficult for the Chancellor of Exchequer. Now David Cameron quite openly turns around and says, we must be doing the right thing because the Governor of the Bank of England says we are. Now, this is not what I understand by independence of the Bank of England. And he has allowed himself to become a deeply political figure.
I think again, this goes beyond individuals. I think there's a massive misunderstanding, even within, as it were, the captains of the state, about what central banks are. Actually, central banks are part of the state. The fact that they look and act independent is just a little bit of an indictment of what the modern state looks like. That is, the key bit of it, and it's this most obvious in America, the key bit of it is immured to democratic control. So in America, Obama did his fiscal stimulus. The stimulus has run out. It's been, as if you saw my reports from America last week, it's been pretty useless in some of the most deprived areas, but it's run out. Next week, they'll vote, and most likely the Democrats will lose control of Congress. Then there's no more stimulus. So the whole fate of economic policy is then decided by Ben Bernanke, an academic appointed by Bush and reappointed by Obama. They don't even give interviews. Mervyn doesn't even give interviews. This is the great weird thing. It is like living in a city-state or the Holy Roman Empire, where the closer you get to power, there's no accountability. I mean, there is accountability through Parliament, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, really, you never see them sit down and give accountability interviews. Now, the central banks are crucial. They're crucial in getting us out of this. The one glimmer of encouragement I take is to see such radical thinking right in the heart of the UK's central bank. I mean, they're thinking more radically than any MP about what they're going to do to the banks, but it will take them decades. And there, I mean, you know the old Orwell dictum, you know, of really Orwell's vision of socialism was, well, we know that in 100 years' time, the working men of England will be living quite a decent life, but why can't we have it in 10? It was a matter of degree, and I suppose you could apply that, because there's an argument that says in all these things you're thinking about doing in the long term, Mervyn, to these banks, you could probably do in the short term, but it would need politics. And you've got the levels of understanding. We all struggle with understanding what these entities are.
Well, aren't we struggling with understanding what happened 2 years ago? In other words, the right wing in this country is trying to pretend nothing much happened. Mm. Rupert Murdoch the other night gave a speech in which he referred to what happened as under the name of the business cycle, is what he called it. He called what happened 2 years ago the business cycle. Now, what he means by that is that he wants to accelerate away from the event and, you know, pretend that nothing very radical has happened. And it's obviously in his interest to pretend that nothing very radical has happened. In other words, the people we might call the mechanics of capitalism, the people who want to, you know, get capitalism working again at the coalface, their interest is in pretending that no great philosophical problem was revealed 2 years ago. The problem, as I understand it, and you're going to correct me on this and tell me whether I'm right or wrong, but the problem that seems to vex economists is the problem of the market and whether the market can be unregulated. The belief about the market through the 80s onwards was that the freer the market was, the fairer it would be. That an idiot who buys 100 things at the wrong price learns by what he or she has bought, because when he or she finds she's unable to sell them, then she has learned a sharp lesson. The cleverer person may have exploited the stupider person, but it doesn't matter because the stupider person has learnt the lesson of the transaction. The transaction is a true transaction because only people who are interested in its outcome take part in that transaction. And so regulation is therefore a bad thing, because somebody coming along to say you ought to do this or you ought not to do that spoils the lesson. In other words, the person doesn't learn the lesson because somebody's interfered in the true transaction, which essentially is what's called entrepreneurial vigor, which is created through the suffering of the person who makes the mistake and the triumph of the person who does the clever thing. Thus, humanity advances through a series of painful lessons. That is the pure market philosophy, as advanced by Ayn Rand, who, as we know, was Alan Greenspan's heroine. And those of you who have not read her books, I recommend them. Atlas Shrugged is where you will find this all.
It's all there.
It's all laid out. And Alan Greenspan wrote for her magazine, in fact, was her amanuensis. And so that was the belief. However, what we saw in this new century were transactions which not only damaged both the people who were making the transaction, but damaged us who had nothing to do with those transactions. Mm. So the problem, the sort of economic problem, which is the belief in a pure transaction between two people that only affects the people involved, is no longer seen to be true.
Yeah.
The consequence of that, one would think, would be to argue for more regulation and to accept that authority lies not with financiers but with politicians. But far from advancing the politician and making politicians bigger, it seems to have made politicians smaller. There's a kind of helplessness in politicians, at least in this country, and indeed in Obama, which is, oh, well, the financiers must now be allowed to sort this out for themselves.
I think you describe half of the problem, and describe it well. I say this in my book. The pure form of it is that the regulator can never know more than either of the two participants. The other bit of it is that the participant always acts in their own interest. So the deal maker always acts in their own interest. That interest is rational. It's a model of human behavior that is frankly weird. But you know, because why do we have psychology if that's always the case? But, you know, leaving that aside, then there's another bit, and that is complexity makes things safer. That you can't underestimate how much the ideal. Look, I'm a big believer in being the old Marxist dictum of being determines consciousness. And when you look at how it was, what society was like, and then you look at the ideas that formed the excrescence on that, it's obvious where they came from. The idea that regulation is bad, everybody acts in their own self-interest, and complexity is good because it makes things safe, perfectly legitimizes one kind of capitalism. That is the Wall Street kind of behavior, and the hedge fund type of behavior. And that is all that it legitimizes. It doesn't even explain the corporate behavior of BP that tries to be green and nice and friendly, but inadvertently screws the entire Mexican Gulf. It doesn't explain that behavior, but it does explain Wall Street. Okay, now I contend in the book that this has been factually disproved. There's not many things you're allowed to say as a BBC correspondent, but that say neoliberalism is rubbish is one of them I think that I can get away with, because I'm prepared, you know, to, you know, the Americans like empiricism. They love empiricism. Empirically, I'll go for hours with anybody who wants to defend it on the evidence. And the, no, okay, why don't they get it? I think some do. I think some people, if you, I was at Davos this year, I mean, I will never be going back. It's one of the most fruitless places one could ever go to. But it is weird because, it is really a series of sort of sessions about why things might be a bit wrong. How could we just slightly tweak things so they're back as where they were? Interlarded with these amazing sessions about how we use piano music to enrich the lives of children. It's as if the whole late 20th century hadn't happened. It really is. But in the edges of it, you could begin to hear people saying, you know what, none of this works. It's there in the discourse. None of it works. You get the occasional big banker. And remember, we had Soros, we had Warren Buffett. You interview in the play Soros. But I was going to ask you, actually, because they give you these glimpses. When you interviewed some of these luminaries, did you not see that look in their eye that they'd lost it? They lost the plot with what this was about.
No, but the luminaries are very, very rich.
Yeah.
And so there is no rich person I have ever met who does not believe they have done something right to become rich.
Yeah.
I mean, that by necessarily, nobody says, oh, you know, I've been incredibly lucky in the markets, you know, and it just happened that this... That of course they believe that they've done something right. But no, the people who are very, very rich can afford to be philosophers, not Rupert Murdoch, because he's still in the game. Mm. But Soros, I mean, symbolically lives at the top of a very high building over which he simply, you know, sits. He reminded me of the Shavian Superman. I mean, he should have really be dressed in a grey, you know, Maoist suit, because he's philosophically so fine. There was a wonderful story about Soros, which I didn't include in the play, which was that he wanted to change, you know, because he had, what is it, $14 billion, I think, something like that. Mm. He wanted to change with his $14 billion from being a financier to being a philosopher. And so he wrote a book of philosophy. And it received an absolutely appalling review by the professor of philosophy at Columbia University, who said it's just absolutely painful to watch this idiot, you know, trying to write philosophy. Really, it's the most embarrassing thing, you know, I've ever seen in my life. And, you know, he's totally unqualified to do this, and the book is an embarrassment. And I said to Soros, so what did you do? He said, I got him to write my second book with me. So that is, in a way, a capitalist answer to a philosophical problem, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Look, they are faced with... The defenders of neoliberalism are faced with the evidence that it doesn't work. And in the book, the new version of the book, I do try and analyse what's happened to Greenspan's thought since he made the famous admission on Capitol Hill that his theory didn't work. And what he's tried to do is to try and enrich the theory with the facts. So good for him, he tried, but I just don't think it works. What he says is, right, what they always fall back on is, look, even if, contrary to my view, people didn't act in their own interests, right, well, could we enact a few reforms to make them do that? See, as soon as you say that, the theory's gone. Sorry. That's not what Ayn Rand was about. Ayn Rand wasn't about making people act in relationship to their natural predilections. They were their natural predilections. Yeah. But then he says, okay, so maybe we could have some regulations that spot this herd behavior at the very end of the bubble and then press down on it. Mm. But then he sort of says, and it's a great bit of open thinking, but that would be bad, because then you wouldn't have a bubble and then a slump. Because at the end of a bubble, you do need a slump, says Greenspan.
Yeah.
You have to have a slump. So all that policy can do is ameliorate the slump. This is from a man who said, literally, when the laws were going through, that complexity, that is derivatives, would prevent any crisis on this scale. So he's now talking about the necessity of slump 10 years after saying slump was impossible, and yet it's all the same theory. I cannot, people who think, you know, Foucault is contradictory, should read Greenspan. This is contradictory. And
but do you think economic theory is... I mean, there was a famous statement I came across where somebody said there's no such thing as economics, there's only economic history. And in other words, all you can ever do is run along behind events and try to interpret and understand them. And I suppose the complaint I'm making is that large sections of the political class in the West are not trying to understand these events.
Yeah, they're
not trying to behave as if they didn't happen.
Yeah, and the reason is, again, I say this in the book, that there is a power elite. And I think to try and understand this without a power elite is the big problem that the third way theorists have. Joe Stiglitz, he's written book after book saying, you know what, capitalism would be better if every so often it was more humane. And then he wonders why it is that even the people who are there at Glen Eagles, cheering on the donation of 0.7% of GDP to the third world, are the very people who have overseen the collapse of the system. Because nowhere in Stiglitz, Nobel Prize or otherwise, is there a social model. He doesn't understand, I don't think, that these agglomerations of power attract power seekers, and that it's not, as it was, say, in 19th century Britain, a permanent power elite. You know, you're not in it, I'm not in it, I don't think many people in this room would be in it. But you can get into it. You have to use the right language, you go to the right things, you say the right things to each other. I've been witness to conversations between some members of this elite, and the entry points are all the right words, the unions are rubbish, the poor are scroungers. All this is what you say, otherwise you don't get to stand there with the cocktail glass in the first place.
Yeah.
But then once you're there, it's the limited range of outcomes, the limited range of solutions.
Yeah.
It would be terrible, of course, if the French people managed to stop their pensions being raised, the pensionable age being raised. So it's an elite. We've had them in the whole of history. I see this myopic reaction as, shall I say this, in a way quite encouraging, because it kind of means when an elite can't adapt, it probably means that we're about to see a change. Ben Bernanke, again, made a speech at Jackson Hole in September where he said, right, I could do X, more QE, I could abandon the inflation target, I could do all kinds of unorthodox things. These are the last bullets in my magazine.
Yeah.
I'm about to fire them. Don't think they're going to change everything.
Yeah.
They won't change much. When you hear a policymaker say that, it occurs to me you might be on the beginnings of a big shift in thinking, and it will be different people.
And tell me, first of all, what do you see as the lessons of the last 2 years? And secondly, how would that shift in thinking be represented?
Right. Go back to my metaphor. What is the acid that's burning through layer after layer of the political, economic and social structure of modern world? I think it's globalization. And in this sense, I'm not anti-globalization. I'm not against the fact that the world is more global, but globalization is based on a contradiction. And it is a contradiction between the fact that China produces, the West consumes. China lends, the West borrows. China grows, at the moment, the West stagnates, or parts of the West stagnate. And there are people who, for 20 years, looked at that duopoly, as it were, and said, well, how like the yin-yang diagram does that look? It's a perfect circle. It's benign. But instead of it being benign, it's just blown up. So the fact that China produced cheap labor denuded America of much of its productive activity. Many of the communities are poor. Don't kid yourself, America's a rich country. It looks like a mid-20th century country in most parts. It looks like a museum. People are poor. Now, the thing is, that can't go on. And I just think that it cannot carry on. And it was always about to produce what it did produce. Here's where I agree with Greenspan. Don't think regulation could have stopped the successive waves of bubble. Because the successive waves of bubble are a response to something much more deep than regulation. It's cheap money. Cheap money in the world that ultimately is a result of China produces and saves. So as long as you've got, I agree with the Bernanke and Greenspan on this, the so-called excess saving theory. Long as you've got that, you're going to get bubbles and busts and booms, and eventually they've overwhelmed the system. So now the world has to be rebalanced. The question is, I mean, I could go into Davos and say the world's got to be rebalanced and everybody will clap, but the question is how? And who will pay? Will it be an orderly rebalancing? Because the China rebalancing story is about is about bringing those Chinese workers up to the level of Czech workers or Romanian workers. For that to happen, Communist Party can't survive. So immediately you've got one-sixth of humanity locked in all kinds of chaos. Do we want that or don't we? Difficult question, actually. I wouldn't urge anybody to rush to a one-word answer. But that's part of the rebalancing. The other part of the rebalancing is what happens to America. They've begun to realise the average income in America stagnated and then it fell by 5%. That is the story of the American middle class for 10 years. It's poorer. What's the result? This, you know, we always used to say American politics is boring because they all agree with each other. It's all done on Capitol Hill. It's all deals. Money buys anything. Money, no amount of money will be able to buy the Democrats a victory on the 2nd of November, and no amount of money buys off that huge plebeian enraged mass because they've seen their lifestyle collapse. So this is what I mean by the rebalancing story. We're in the era of rebalancing. I think one of the important things people can do is begin to envision what it would be like. There's an absence of vision about what it might be like if we were to successfully get to the other side of this. Rebalancing the world.
Yeah, but is that? Do you think the rage that you've been reporting on in Newsnight, the rage in America, do you think it's under? It's specifically about what's happened in the last 2 years, or do you think it's about what you're talking about—the shift of power between China and America, and the sense that it's not going to be another American century?
It's all of those things, but they could kid. Look, they lived middle class lifestyles on working class wages. So the wages don't rise, they stagnate. But cars, you know, consumer goods, everybody got more. And ultimately, homes. There are currently, I think, off the top of my head, 1.5 million repossessed homes. It might be 2.5 million. There is a, you know, it's a terrible crisis. If everything that was core to being the American middle class, home ownership, car ownership, health insurance, there are now 50 million people in America without health insurance. 10 years ago, there were 40 million. Keep going, and you'll end up with half the population of it. This is, okay, so these are deep things that they are going through, and their response is effectively a cathartic response to a moment in America's decline. But it's only cathartic because, first of all, the Lords of Finance, their reputations collapse. You could at least say, well, we don't like these guys, but you know, they've got nothing to do with it. They own Picasso's and they love modern art. They go and see plays by David Hare. And you know your play was full of very rich capitalists and up there in the rich, in the expensive seats. But we don't, we gun talk. I went to a Glenn Beck event where the thing on sale was a coffin with woodland camouflage on it. You know, the kind that hunters wear. You can buy it in Walmart. And on the lid it said, gone hunting. And this is what they like, that's their culture. But they can live with it as long as it delivers more credit. As soon as it doesn't, it's an existential problem for them. And I don't think it's, the coastal elite in America just sees this as a sort of blip, and I just don't see it as a blip. It's one of these symptoms of big shake-up. So you see, I think that what's emerging is, unlike you, I don't see this as a finished episode. I see it as a sort. I see the acid still burning through the floors.
Just in self-defence, I did ask for the prices to be lowered, especially at the theatre, because I did think that it was completely ridiculous that you put on a play about the financial crisis and then you charge £45 to people to go to it. And I did actually make sure that especially cheap, and we were very pleased to have done that. But just going on about the political side of this, obviously, the feeling that's created in everybody in the West is a feeling of profound helplessness, isn't it? That they feel themselves, in other words, the political elite is completely aligned with the financial elite. The political elite appears to exist entirely at the service of the financial elite. You can't tell which is running the country. Mervyn King appears to be running the country at the moment. And so the rest of us are entirely excluded from the any process of decision making. Mm. Now, I assume David Cameron's Big Society is some philosophical attempt to deal with that sense. In other words, to persuade people that they do have a stake in the outcome of all these huge arguments that are going on at the moment, and to convince them that they can do something to exert some kind of influence over the way they live. But it doesn't look like it's sticking at the moment, does it?
Big Society.
Yeah.
I mean, I think I'm not cynical. A lot of Tories are cynical about the Big Society, and a lot of journalists are. I mean, I have sort of studied the rise of the man who's behind the idea, which is Philip Blond, who's the so-called author of Red Tory, who came from, I think, University of Central Lancashire to, and I think that Res Publica now, I mean, I think its premises are sort of, you know, sort of palatial. So, because he suddenly hit on the idea, it hit on the idea not only for the British polity, but for the world. Because if the state must shrink because the acid has burned through the fiscal stability of many countries, then there's only one, there's two alternatives. One is the Thatcher alternative, which is overtly have a policy of letting the poor suffer and of cutting back the state and of saying, well, there is no such thing as society, as she said, or you do the opposite. You look for a one nation mutualist palliative. And I think if you look at what it is, here's the programme. It's quite anti-city. National pool of local pools of capital. We need another Stoke-on-Trent. We need another. We need local capitalists to invest in local places, and then we need another. Blond is quite sympathetic to the labour movement. He wants the labour movement to revive as a mutualist. You know, remember. You know, where did Nye Bevan read all his Marxist literature in a library paid for by miners? You occasionally find one of these books in a second-hand bookshop. I'm really proud to own one of these books that was in one of these miners' libraries. It's about the Paris Commune, and they were sitting there reading by, you know, what, Gaslight. One shouldn't romanticise that mutualist past of the Labour and Christian socialist movement in Europe. But the point is, I think what they're trying to say to us is we're not going the other way. We genuinely want to try and create a social solution to a collapsing state. Does it work? Difficult, really difficult, because there's no capacity. I mean, as I say, you go into a mining village and you say, right, that pit that's been the centre of it for, what, 50, 100 years, we don't need that anymore. So that's gone now. All right, you know, jobs you're not going to have. Social cohesion, well, you know, find another way of doing it. Get on your bike, or if you're still there, oh, right, your kids have gone into drugs. There isn't enough money to police or do the social work. That's unfortunate. We're very sorry, but that's modern society. Watch the wire if you think you're on your own. You go at the end of that 10, 15-year process and say, right, the state's screwed. Anybody want to set up a voluntary organisation in this village? If it was a foreign country, DFID would send people in, and the first thing that they'd say is, "There's no capacity. This village has been so devastated by war. The voluntary organisations are, and people hate each other. Remember that as well. So much, the two sides. We can't build anything here until we do capacity building. That's what DFID would do in place like Humberside or South Wales. So it's gonna be difficult, the Big Society. But I do think it's a sort of de nos jours idea, and I don't think just the fact that Cameron supports it should mean that everybody who doesn't like Cameron just should write it off. Because I'm picking up within Labour and within social democracy in Europe a big sort of recognition that, look, I'll caricature it. Is it such a great model that what you exist to do is to be a conveyor belt of benefits to poor communities that can never escape poverty? Do you just accept that's what it is? Or that you have to create employment because the private sector can't? The British private sector's problems go beyond the 80s as well. They go back 100 years. Is that, as John Ruskin says, can we not dream a better dream than that? I think that debate is starting now within Labour. But the diehards say, no, it's good that Newcastle is 70% dependent on the state for GDP.
Yeah.
And then another lot say, maybe not.
I'm going to finish my little bit and open this out, but just with one more question. What you're talking about is what Tony Judt talked about in Ill Fares the Land, which I imagine is a book other people here have read. And what he's really saying is that he can't remember a time in his lifetime in which people were not licensed to dream about how things might be different. In other words, he's saying what characterises this point, 2010, is that whereas people have always had an idea of how, I was asking you about the Tea Party movement and what was the idea earlier, you know, people have had an always had an idea, oh, society might be organised differently. I can imagine a society that is organised differently. But there is a sort of fatalism that he detects in the way people now talk about the inexorability of this process. Globalisation is obviously the large part of it, over which it which will roll over our lives and over which we have absolutely no control. And the loss of this capacity to dream is really what he's identifying. But do you think that after this crisis, there is the beginning of dreaming again on the left and on the right?
Well, we are living remarkably non-ideological times. Even the right, if you start with the right, it's incredibly non-ideological. I did this jokey piece to camera on Newsnight. It said, why is everything about, why had both parties decided to use the slogan fairness? Because I don't even think fairness is a word. You know, I'd never heard it used normally in the pub, but what about fairness, guys? for the right, you know, would Winston Churchill have, ordered the cabinet to die choking on their own blood as he did in May 1940 for fairness? You know, and likewise, would anybody have gone on a barricade for it? That's the danger with that. So I don't see us being at a very ideological pass, but then I am also quite enthused by the individual creativity of people. And I think, you know, people in my generation who come from that sort of state capitalist era of solidarity and organizations and hierarchies tended to be a bit sniffy about when people started doing things for themselves online and producing their own little hip-hop record or whatever. And you think, well, that's not, you know, you can do it, but you'll never be Mozart. Do you know what I mean? And I now think that it's in through the pursuit of these little minor individual utopias that we are going to get the if you read in Lady Chatterley's Lover, Lawrence describes Mellors having this kind of fantasy of what life could be like for him as a mining community. And it's bizarre and facile, actually. It's all about it's Lawrence's own fantasy, and it's about everybody has to wear a red jacket that exposes the buttocks of the man. Do you read? It's one of these things that it's not the most thumbed page of that book. But it's an interesting thing, isn't it? So what is it really saying is that before the internet, people had all these weird ideas about how they'd like to, what utopia they'd like to live in, but they couldn't express them. No, they can. We're at a utopian stage for the left. I mean, we're at a rebuilding stage where you don't think, what shall we do, but what would we like if everything would really go right again? And I think instead of these collective utopias in the early 19th century, they were nearly always handed out, doled out by rich people. Remember, you know, I've written a bleeding book about him, the French socialist Saint-Simon was a count, and Owen was a factory owner. People are building their own little utopias, and I think it's out of that that the discourse will come about the reimagining of where we want to be. But we're not at that stage.
It does chime that during the general election, the most interesting claim I heard anybody make was Nick Clegg did stand up and say exactly this. He said, under a Liberal Democrat government, life will be fair, he said. Which was the largest claim I've ever heard a politician make. Anyway, let's ask Paul some questions, please. Oh, my goodness. OK, so many. Let's start. Should we start here, then?
Thank you. Wonderful presentation and excellent fodder for debate. I have a very simple question that both you gentlemen didn't address, and it's called accountability for the average middle-class person, the one that goes out and gets 20 different credit cards, runs it out to the absolute max, then all of a sudden there's a crash, and all of a sudden they're asked to pay back. And I think there has to be something said not that the state or the big financiers, that we, everyone sitting in this room and the wider world as well, have to take some responsibility and not say, oh my God, I'm a victim. You know, I'm tired of hearing I am a victim, and I'm curious why both you gentlemen haven't discussed tonight the debate of being accountable for your own responsibility, having an ethic and a morality about how you spend money. If you earn X amount of money, you don't spend three times of X and think someone's going to finance that. And then when the banks finally collapse and you have no more money, what do you do? So I'm curious what your thought is about accountability of the average person out there for the collapse.
It's useless asking me. I'm Scottish, and so... It's just ingrained in me that you don't spend more money than you have. It's just that that's what my mother taught me.
Look, let me put it this way. The UK is lucky to have a school of economic thinkers called the Financialization School. They're based at SOAS, and their stuff is worth reading. They've influenced me since I wrote the first edition of the book. I've tried to put some of it in this. What they argue is that there's a major change in economic structure gone on during the globalized epoch, in which the population of the Western countries has come to have a direct relationship with their exploiters, as they put it, through finance rather than through work. And therefore, you know, one way of thinking about it is that the capitalist who makes the most money out of one's labor is not your employer, but it's the person who owns your credit card, because 18, 20, 25% is a lot. Now, if you buy the financialization thesis, as it's called, what they say is that people's individual mode of behavior comes to see themselves as a financial asset. They come to see themselves, and the more savvy consumers see themselves, of course, there are non-savvy consumers. I know people who've gone out and spent maxed out on these credit cards, and they're frankly stupid. But I also know people who see themselves as a financial node in a financial system. No, it is not illogical. If that financial system says, okay, be hard-headed. Be as hard-headed as you can and max out your advantage to yourself. If they offer you, in other words, 10 grand credit card, get the 10 grand now. That's the first thing. The next thing they say to you is complexity is good. Complexity is safe. So the more credit cards you've got, the safer you're going to be. Think about it. That's what Wall Street was doing. It was taking huge leveraged bets on fixed pool of assets. All the consumers are, I'm not defending them. I think you're right to say there's a big consumption behavior that's got to change. But what was the rational basis of it was to say, well, if I'm just the same as a mini bank here, me, Paul Mason, and if Lehman Brothers can leverage itself to 70 times its assets, so can I.
Yeah.
That's the logic behind it. I do think it has to change. It's ended. It's over. And it's going to be really hard if it ends in a big crash, because I think that's still one of my potential
outcomes.
It's
absolutely true. What Paul says, that I met so many people who believed that they could leverage themselves in exactly the same way that banks leveraged. And it's a generational belief to do with having been brought up in that world of leverage. That's what it came from.
But no, you're talking about them... super intelligent or the quasi intelligent having this perspective that they're going to be like the bank. My question is more basic.
Yeah.
My question is simply the average person with a little bit of avarice says, I want those pair of Jimmy Choo's. I want that Gucci watch. I want that Rolex. And with my 25 different credit cards, which I can split up, the Rolex cost me $5,000. I can split that up amongst five different credit cards and pay it out in perpetuity. It's that kind of consumer, and there are a lot of them out there that I know a few, that the irresponsibility is the question that they have to share in the collapse of the financial situation we are experiencing globally, I think.
Agree.
Next, please.
It seems to me that behind it all, there is, I'm sorry, I'm French, so my English sometimes is a bit faulty. There's one big assumption, is that growth, economic growth, is absolutely essential. Can't we question that? Or the whole cards are going to collapse?
No, I mean, this is an idea that's coming you know, on into the interview, isn't it? I mean, I have to say, I don't address that in my book. I think it's a different thing. I mean, however, you could put it this way: if what remains of the world's population that doesn't have the advanced lifestyle wants that lifestyle, a new way has got to be found to deliver it to them. I am not personally anti-growth. I don't buy the inevitability of low growth. I tend to be very, like me and George W. Bush, quite, I believe, you know, there are technical solutions to a lot of things. Whether or not that comes on the other side of a big crisis is a different question. But I think what this crisis has done, it's brought the two major crises of growth into tactical range. That is, we used to think, you know, some of my colleagues here, I think we probably thought the aging crisis will happen in the mid-21st century, and the resource crisis, if it's true at all, because it's been on and off ever since I was at junior school, whether we're going to have one, but whether things are going to run out. But if it does happen, it'll be again sometime in the middle of the century. But now, the aging crisis is there. My pension is going to be about 20% less than what it was 3 weeks ago. Because the BBC decided that the ageing crisis has hit them. That's real. And it's going to get as worse as it's going to ever get for me and my colleagues in the next 5 years. And likewise on oil, likewise on green, on the planet, likewise on resource allocation. Even now, one of the things I write about in the book is the commodity spike of mid-2008, the last big party before it all went wrong. There's another one underway. Oil's 83, gold, gold's gone crazy. But do I think low growth's a solution? Not until the people I meet in India and China get electricity to their hut. I don't think it's a solution personally.
Sir.
If Stiglitz doesn't get it, is Krugman pointing in the right direction in getting it? Or is America today a Weimar Germany with 250 million guns?
That's a brilliant. Do you want to have a go at that?
No, it's you, Paul.
Okay, go on, look, because I'm just trying to, you know, that's a great, the reason I said that is because I think it's intuitive minds are going to grasp this. That's a great question. Look, what the questioner is referring to is that in America there's this whole Plan B party around Obama, the New York Times, Krugman, Stiglitz, et al., Huffington Post. They all want a second stimulus, much more radical policy. The unions, see in my film the other day, unions saying we want you to take on Wall Street. No, it's not going to happen. So whoever's right, we have to say that the starting point is he's not going to do it. If anything, he moves right after next week. But are the left Keynesians right to obsess about fiscal stimulus, which is what they are obsessed about? Personally, I have always thought the monetary stimulus is the one that would work in America. That is low interest rates and put money in people's pockets. Use tax cuts if you have to. And the reason goes beyond ideology. The job of a journalist is to go to places and ask questions that nobody else is asking. And I have relentlessly focused on parts of America that I've been to. And I've gone and I've said, I just cannot see how they can spend money. I can't see it. There's no capacity. The local state doesn't want to spend it. None of the bureaucrats know how to. The channels are so atrophied because of 30 years of neoliberalism that nobody in power believes it's a moral thing to do. And I'm talking about some lowly guy who's in charge of renewing the streetlights in Gary, Indiana. He would like to, but you can even then say, well, is this wasteful? I mean, it's heretical on the left to say this. I think and at the moment there's a big propaganda campaign by Stiglitz and Krugman to say second stimulus. I think if they have a second stimulus, it has to be, the key thing is it's got to put money into the pockets of ordinary people in America, and then it's nothing to do with stimulus. It's a total blitz on the banks. It may involve nationalisation, but what it means is that you take control of them and you micromanage them to make them into a conveyor belt for credit into the economy. I'll tell you, I've said this in an article this week, unless that happens in the New Statesman on Thursday, unless there is some defibrillating moment in America, they're going to face stagnation. I can't see any other outcome to the situation. But is it Weimar Germany? Blimey. See, Obama is involved in this culture war. And up to now, Wall Street have been his allies. You know, the one of the most gay-friendly places is New York. And even Wall Street, with its old-fashioned traditions. You know, I've been in their offices. They do have Picassos on the wall. They don't think Picasso is a kind of crazy pervert, you know, whatever. They love that culture of the 20th century modernity. And if America goes into this low-level culture war, you know, it's Obama and Wall Street and the East Coast elite and the educated sort of middle classes and the Mexicans and the African Americans against the middle. But, you know, do not wish for it to happen because, again, touching, you know, being there, it's very visceral. It's very visceral. You know, the majority of the Tea Party believe Obama is a Muslim. They believe it. And they believe it as profoundly as you believe, you know, that, you know, Don McCullough's picture is a brilliant picture. They really, it's true for them. It's not ideology.
Can I say, I think for politicians, these problems are technically so complicated. Paul understands them, but it is a real problem of understanding. And I learnt about finance at the same time that Obama learnt about it. And he's a much cleverer man than I am. But I knew, the one thing I understood was how deep people's understanding was of the subject. You can tell. And I knew he knew as little as I did. I could see him learn. He was learning at exactly the same point, same pace. He had a much better grasp of it because he probably had much better advisors. And he was crash coursing in it because it wasn't his background. He was interested in social justice, foreign relations. He was interested in the war. Mm. He was interested in, obviously, in the plight of minorities in America. Those were the things that he was interested in. Instead, he inherited a massively complicated financial situation that he had to master and be expected to be able to come up with solutions to. And I could see that he didn't really understand it. And almost the most shocking thing that happened to me during the writing of the play was that a very senior Labour politician who was at the very top of the government when Nick Heitner, who was running the National Theatre, he asked, what's David Hare writing at the moment? And he said, he's writing a play about the financial crisis. And the politician put his head in his hands and said, oh God, I've got an opinion about everything, but I haven't got an opinion about that. And so it is that you feel, and I know this feeling because I had it myself, that you're permanently running to catch up with something which you for a second you think you've got hold of, and then it's out of reach. At the back, please. Yeah.
I want to ask if your book will make us explain what's going on, and when will like people like you explain to simple people like us lucidly so that big ideas are not so difficult.
I have the Latin teacher problem. You know, Latin teachers have always got the book under the desk, kind of learn what is a moa mater. Listen to this. I have that. I'm not a trained economist. I'm a journalist. And therefore, all I've deployed into this is the skill of listening to people and asking the right questions. And going and also, what I constantly do is kind of turn over in my mind the things that are bugging me. What is it that's been bugging me? Why is this... I've got no foresight. Only after the euro collapse did I realise what had been bugging me about Greece was why so many of Greeks had suddenly got four-wheel drives and finished their villas that they hadn't finished for 30 years. How did that happen? In 10 years, you kind of presumed, well, there's a boom going on. But really, it was just the whole. You know, Europe basically said, look, you know, you've had fascism, we don't want any more civil war, take as much money as you can, we won't ask any questions, enrich yourselves. Now, only afterwards does it become clear that this was just built on falsehoods and lies. Now, the reason I use this as an example is because I don't think any of this is hard, but you've got to put away ideology, and it's quite... Well, think about it. What education has one been offered on these issues? Well, suddenly about 10, 15 years ago, there was a fad for financial education. Children must learn about what it is to have a mortgage. Well, did anybody ever tell them that, you know, you can lose your house at the end of it all in any of these financial education classes? Clearly not in America, because something like 2.5 million people have lost their homes. So, right, look, the book is a journalistic account of what went on. And it's in a way, if you read it, if you with your antennae should be able to read that bits of it are me just frantically struggling to understand what's going on. I mean, I'm frantically piecing things together. I didn't put the full story in the original book, but there's a great story about AIG. And things come together in your mind. AIG was the big one that really went. That's what finished it all off, not Lehman. And as I read about AIG, it's not all out there on the internet. Buy the books of everybody who's ever worked at AIG. And there's one who is the lieutenant for the boss. And he said, right, he describes how by registering itself in the state of Delaware, which has the loosest regulation, it got away with no regulation. So that's how you do in America. Okay, this is where this Christine O'Donnell is standing for Congress. So then he says, just in passing, he said, at one point, the regulators in Delaware did start sniffing around AIG, but the boss, Hank Greenberg, hired some private detectives to look into their private lives. And guess what? They stopped looking into the AIG. And I read that and I thought, hold on a minute. Right, anybody heard of Elliot Spitzer? Okay, Elliot Spitzer is the prosecutor who took down AIG. 6 months after he took them down, he was discovered wiring illegal money to a prostitution ring in New York. Okay, now I don't say anything, you know, causal in this, but it is remarkable what you can find when you delve back into the prehistory of this. And I just say, if you read the book, it's me trying to make these synaptic connections and say, right, what is going on here? And I come to the conclusion, it's neoliberalism, it's a power elite, it's an unsustainable global model of which this latest boom was only one, and if we don't do something about it, rebalancing it, we'll just have more and more bubble burst and, you know, hubristic, crazy outbursts, which is what we had in a decade.
If I can just reinforce, the book really does. I can understand it, and I really can. And what's also so great about it is that it's not that it's ideology, but it's following an argument. And it is in the last two chapters saying this is where the argument now resides and this is the stuff that has to be settled. And I think Paul's made clear tonight that there isn't yet any answer. These are questions to which people about which people are thinking, but to which the answers are not yet obvious. Let's take another question. Yes, right at the back there, shall we?
Hi, my name is Charlotte Middlehurst. I've recently started writing for a financial magazine on foreign exchange, and I was wondering to what extent you think the economic future of the West will be decided by the behaviour of Asian markets and Asian financiers. And just to sort of put it in context, I'm thinking about currency wars and also what was announced at G20 over the weekend.
Yeah.
Right, well, just to contextualise this, what's happened since May, since phase three opened, is this. Everywhere where this growth is slowing, they are printing more money and slashing interest rates. And as a result, what that does, all other things being equal, it weakens your currency. So Japan's doing it, America's doing it, Britain's done it. Europe thought it would get away without doing it because when the euro nearly collapsed, the euro currency tanked. But because everybody else has done this, they haven't said, let's get our currency down. They've just taken actions that make the currency go down. So we've got a multi sort of network style global currency war that they tried to put a lid on this weekend. They didn't. I've likened it to Chamberlain, piece of paper. It's still going on right now because they're all pursuing the pro, the down, the depreciatory policies. The only one that isn't is China, and it is resisting the rise of its own currency against a basket of other currencies. And why? Because they put it really clearly. It's about social order. Social order in China cannot resist a rise in wage costs or a rise in costs in general. So the future of the world is going to be decided by a mixture of that. I say phase three is about conflicts between countries and conflicts between classes. Remember, it's a short hop from currency war to trade war. Everybody does it. You all cut. Come 20 months later, you look and you say, actually, we've got minimal advantage for this. So the next thing we do is trade sanctions. Once you're in that world, you're in the world of the 1930s. You've gone beyond Weimar. You're in the world of Hallmark, Schacht and Keynes, the creation of continent-wide currency unions maybe that's the way it goes. It certainly does decide things. And what I keep saying to people is, look, if you want to analyze the coalition's CSR that came out last week, there's no way of analyzing it short of knowing what it's doing on money printing, what it's doing on currency, and what everybody else is doing on currency and money printing. This is what, in a report by the IMF, they say the only way it's going to work is if the big forces go the right way for Britain, and therefore they have to go the wrong way for somewhere else. Now, I think it's, one ought not to advocate trade war and sanctions and the rest of it, but I think we are going to see a rise in that discourse. You know, we're going to see very short term, actually, in Britain. Apparently, Robert Peston said this on the BBC, so I think it must be true, that most of the jobs created in the last quarter in Britain went to non-UK nationals. Okay, that's fine for a quarter. We get to 5 years' time, and all these 6 million welfare-dependent people that Tories are so worried about go off benefits and not into jobs, and the jobs are filled by another 500,000 A8 migrants. Stand by for something bad, because you can't keep doing that. It's fine here, where there's lots of jobs, you know, probably go downstairs to the restaurant, lots of people happily coexisting. But out there in the sticks, where there's nothing, it's not sustainable. So I think the first protectionist thing you're going to see in British discourse will be about migration. Which, that's on a happy note, but I mean, that is likely, I think.
Yes, over there.
Hey, I'm just struck that I'm sitting in a room that's celebrating journalism, and there are lots of pictures of wars, but there are no pictures of great financial journalists standing outside stock exchanges. I just wonder, does the media have to take some responsibility for not taking financial journalism seriously in the past? In that sense, weren't we ready for the crisis? Yeah. Maybe also playwrights should take responsibility. David, you've talked about this being your first play about finance. If you had been writing about finance more in the past 20 years, maybe we could have avoided the financial crisis.
It is true that the London School of Economics, Howard Davis, who in fact appeared in the play as a character, had been, even before the crash, a couple of years before the crash, had been asking about why is so little of the culture about the things that are going on that are unique, that was happening, that it was so clear if you were sitting at the London School of Economics that something was happening during that decade that had not happened before. And I don't think those of us who were outside understood. We understood, you know, when the crash came, then we understood those events. And it is true that I suppose the world of culture and money, goodness me, they are so... they have traditionally been so separated, haven't they? I remember in the 1980s when somebody said to me, and it was actually the inspiration of a play I wrote called The Secret Rapture, somebody did say to me, do you not know that everybody has been making money hand over fist? And I said no, and they said, don't you have any investments? And I said no, and I was completely ignorant. And this was an extremely well-known novelist who I shall not name, but who began his morning's writing by spending an hour with the Financial Times. And he simply sat and did his stocks and shares from 9 till 10, rang his broker at 5 to 10, having drawn his conclusions for the day, and then proceeded to write his beautifully written novels for the rest of the day. And he saw nothing unusual in that. But the cultures have been very, very separate. And I immediately began to write about those poor idiots who think they can, in quotes, just live their lives. And it was a very rich subject to write about, people who imagine that they can, in quotes, just live their life without noticing what's happening financially in the rest of the society. And it did wake me up, but obviously not enough.
Well, just to stray into your territory a bit, one of my friends had run a small experimental theatre that read something like 2,000 scripts a year. And I said to her on the outbreak of the crisis, what do people send you? What do young people send you? And it was interesting because she said, what we get from working class writers is this dystopian top of a tower block thing about how life is totally meaningless for them and there's no future. Now, I think in one sense, that was throughout the 2000s, that was telling us something. I also think in the movies, I mean, it's no accident that Slavoj Žižek is the sort of celebrated, auteur or whatever now, because, well, actually, when we look back at the 2000 decade, there were a lot of movies that were about simply this: reality isn't as it appears. The Matrix is the movie about that. But there's lots of other ones, that beautiful mind thing. Do you know, reality is a facade, and something behind it is going on that we can't touch or feel. That's very much how I feel when I'm trying to understand finance. You try and understand a derivative. You know, those old things that I take a penny and follow its progress through the world, you know, from the shopkeeper to the butcher to the... You can't do that with a derivative. It doesn't... parts of it don't exist. So I feel there was a cultural signal coming at us about this. Now, was journalism to blame? Even before I slag everybody else off, I'll say my stuff, I'd even say, was to blame. I had a different model of reality than what actually was in reality. My model was, because I came from a computing background, I believe that the solo paradox is over, that the computers and IT are laying the basis for a big 50-year advancement of human technical and productive capability. And I believed that from 1999. There was a big debate. I decided what I believed. And so when I saw what was happening in the 2000s decade, I thought, this is decade one of a long upturn. And it, coinciding with it was the rise of a new labor movement in China, in India, which I went to. I thought, well, what I'll do, because this is like the 1910s, I'll go out and log the emergence of the new syndicalist mass-type movement. And it never occurred to me that, in fact, the slump that had taken place after dot-com and the Asian 1997 crisis were just the tremors before the big one, because I thought that 1999 had been it. And so all my thinking was, in fact, shaped by that. Now, if that's me, and I'm, I think, a quite decent journalist, lots of other people just went, oh, house prices, up. Can they ever go down? And were shocked when you said they might do. So, but that's, I think, again, if you trace it back to what I, as it were, misunderstood, you trace back the logical reason why everybody else might have misunderstood it, because it did, reality presented itself differently than what it actually was.
I mean, just to very quickly finish that, just to confirm, it's not so much dystopia. I've just judged a Yale Drama Prize where I've read 1,000, or been responsible, I didn't personally, I've been responsible for a reading of 1,000 plays, and most of them American. They are not so much dystopian as apocalyptic. I mean, if we saw one more person crawling across a blackened landscape that had been destroyed by terrorists or... and now you can obviously say, oh, that's 9/11. The American mainland has for the first time been, you know, violated. And so the result is, I mean, there were wonderful plays about will a gay relationship survive the apocalypse? That sort of, you know, what does this mean for our relationship that there's no civilization left? You know, which was one, you know, there were a lot along those lines. But that to me, I know I'm completely... the levels of violence at the cinema just seem to me absolutely astonishing. When I go and watch 10 trailers for films, they all appear to be about the great fantasy of destroying our society, which has become incredibly powerful. And you know, it's beyond burning cars or burning buildings. It's now burning cities and burning civilizations. And so something's going on of an apocalyptic nature, plainly. Yeah.
In 3D.
In 3D, yeah. back again?
Yeah, I have my own interest in the apocalyptic tradition. I'm a vicar in Hackney. And I go and stand on the roof of my church. And I'm just, you know, checking that my parishioners aren't up to mischief. And I look across the estates of East London towards... the new cathedrals of our great cities, the City of London. This is where we look to for our guidance. And the way you've described the kind of looking through the glass dimly, not being able to understand quite what's going on in this reality that's ever... I mean, it sounds like Rowan Williams describing God. And it occurs to me that actually... I mean, nowadays when people talk about something being theological... they mean completely nonsense and making no sense at all. And it strikes me that actually what you're describing is a kind of theological system that doesn't need, as you're suggesting, a kind of no or lack of ideology to confront it, but actually needs a strong alternative ideology or theology to confront it. Otherwise we're going to find ourselves in a considerable mess, or continue to find ourselves. And I just, you know, I would suggest that instead of reading your books on IT, Paul, you consult Augustine and his doctrine of original sin. That might help you to understand your you know, mental torture of the last decade.
Well, you know what? I did actually do something on Newsnight about Cartesian dualism coming back, because there's a theory that if you consider the computer but also be in a computer game, where are you? And it goes back to the medieval view of that you can be both a body and a soul. So this could appeal to you, because a lot of vicars wrote to me after that. So you can't say I haven't engaged in that, but actually there is this meme, and it's probably got nothing to do with the finance thing, but there's this meme, this rising theme, as it were, of being in one place and being in another place, that I think is a revolt against the knownness, the materiality of what culture became. But I mean, look, I'd say one of the strongest bits in the book is the critique of neoliberalism, because I describe it as it started out as the theory of the rising financial class, but it became a secret religion for the super rich, because actually they outsourced philanthropy to Blair, you know, to the G8, to Gordon Brown, to Oxfam and ActionAid, but in their secret religion, you go to the parties where there are only hedgies and journalists and all the rest of it, and newspaper proprietors. The secret religion is still there. They believe the Randy. They believe, you know, it is not unknown for Atlas Shrugged to be given out at the end of a certain venture capital fund's public meetings. Okay, on the big door, big online mine, which you might have to buy, they give out Atlas Shrugged. And if you know it, it's a chorizo, it's this thick. Yeah. They believe it. They totally believe everything in it. So you're right, there needs to be, but it's not for me to construct an alternative thing. And I'm very wary of alternative theologies to it. But the one thing you can say that it always denied was the, you know, what you might call mercy. You cannot have mercy in the system. In fact, Ayn Rand, 60 pages of speech at the very end by John Galt on the radio. What's the slogan? I can't quote it from memory because I hate the slogan. It's I will never knowingly be good to another person. I can't remember. Somebody knows Ayn Rand. That's it. I will never knowingly sacrifice my own interest to help somebody else who demands my help.
I'm going to take one last question, but just before I do, if I can speak to the same thing, I found them culturally the most self-absorbed group of people that I've ever had anything to do with. You know, I've written about all sorts of sections of society. I've written about the police. Indeed, I've written about the church. And I've always found it a thrill and a pleasure to go among professional groups and see what it is they're interested in, because their curiosity about things, it always sparks my curiosity. When I was talking to the financial community, if one may call them that, they were more self-absorbed, and finally, they are only interested in each other. They're not interested in anything else. And I kept hearing, like a little musical theme, over and over, I'd hear these words, the Sunday Times Rich List, the Sunday Times Rich List. Most days, somebody would mention, and on the Sunday Times Rich List, and people would say, oh, it's a terrible day, that day the Sunday Times publishes its rich list, and I go down in my pajamas, one man said, and, you know, I see where I am on that list, you know, whether I've gone up and down on that list, and where so-and-so is, and I often get a lot of pleasure from seeing that so-and-so's dropped 100 places. And you cannot believe that a group of people are so uninterested in the impact of what they do on the rest of the world. But they're not. It is peer group judgment entirely. And it's they're interested in each other. They're not interested in us. And when that whole business was going on about why don't the bankers apologize, it was an insane question to ask. Who were they going to apologise to? Each other? They certainly weren't going to apologise to us because we're not in their landscape. That we're just outside their landscape. Well, last question. Ellen.
Except it's not entirely true in that
as we've just been reading, the Tea Party movement, which is the landscape, is actually being financed by them, which the wonderful New Yorker piece about the Koch brothers, who we all never heard of. And so as they feel threatened, they're using their money and power to finance greed and the movements caused by greed and fear, which don't necessarily produce anything politically good, going back to Weimar. It's scary, I think.
I think, look, Karl Polanyi, who is by no means a leftist, had this theory about capitalism that produces two impulses. One is the impulse we described, the greed impulse, the individualistic impulse, and the other one, and it breaks down all natural social bonds. It's the same thing that Marx describes. It breaks down everything and all medieval life, all family life, and reduces it to a cash nexus. And my goodness, 150 years on from that phrase, how true it is. But Polanyi said, it creates its opposite as well. It creates the counter movement, the movement for solidarity and humanity. And I think that is what we are. That's the time we're living in. At the end of the book, the new edition, I say this. Look, somebody once said to Keynes, look, Keynes, you're not really an economist. All you do is you wander around the world and you intuit what the spirit of the age is, and then you give it a philosophical, theoretical gloss. And in that spirit, I mean, I try to draw a couple of conclusions. And one of them is, different to even the world I was born in, social justice seems to be an inalienable right. The idea that social justice is, as Glenn Beck calls it, evil and imposed by Marxism on the church, and you should leave any church that espouses it, doesn't seem to be a majority view in society. Even conservatives believe that there should be some social justice. And that all should take part in the banquet of life, as it were. That's seen, and people's view of their individuality, which I think has grown, it's expanded in my lifetime, but certainly in, say, my mother's lifetime, 75 years. Their view of their individual potential has grown. This is, you can spend your life lamenting the death of solidarity, which I do, but you can miss in the process realizing what a great positive force the individuality is, and if something good comes out of this, it will be the assertion out of all these little, as I said before, the little utopias into something different that I think will create the counter movement. And the other thing I'd say is that when I saw your play and I saw the first preview and I saw my good self depicted in it for two or three lines on stage. I came back and I thought, well, I know all this, and I kind of talked it through, and we talked it through what we thought about it, and then it slept, and then about 4 a.m. I just woke up and I thought, no, it has told me something more, and it was literally about the unsustainability of that world. It is unsustainable, and when you interface with them all the time, as I do, this belief rubs off on you. And what I think you taught us, David, in that play, is the sort of ridiculousness of it, actually, the ridiculousness of it, but in a very profound way. So look, nobody must go away from any of my talks, my journalism, my reportage on the current situation, which is very negative on the outcome, thinking that I think the outcome's negative for humanity, because we can go into this forearmed with Weimar, forearmed. People say, no, I don't draw a direct parallel between Tea Party and fascism at all. But people say, look, when you hear the rich in America go, we can use them. We've used them before. We can contain them. People write into Newsnight blogs saying, what happened when people said that in Weimar? people, they're not stupid. They're, you know, I don't think there was a book in my local Lee Library in 1960, you know, the 1960s about Weimar. But now you can look it up on Wikipedia. That's good. So that's the end, I suppose.
Okay, I'm gonna end by thanking Paul for his fantastic book. To me, he's one of the reasons for the universal license fee. I feel, and which, you know, by an act of benign socialist intervention has been frozen now at £146 for the next 6 years. And so he will become more and more of a bargain every night. he will cost us less and less in the market, but that the market in this case does not reflect his value. And so I want to thank him for everything he's done to help and enlighten me with these questions, but also for this thoroughly entertaining book and talk. And I hope very much those of you who haven't read the book will buy a copy now, because it really is great. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David.